It's my great pleasure to welcome Christian Petzold to the Deutsches Haus today. He is known to most of you, I think, through his Gespenster or Ghost trilogy. He studied first drama and theater in Berlin before moving to film, and he has basically won every prize in the book that you can win for his films, or nearly every prize. And I wondered, I was actually intrigued. I mean, you can read about his biography on the little handouts you've gotten, but I was actually intrigued by the little biography that he has at the end of the DVD, The State I Am In, Die Innere Sicherheit. And there he tells us that he was born in 1960 in Hahn, a tiny little town, a Schlafstadt, a sleeper city, a suburban town between Wuppertal, Solingen, and Düsseldorf. Two highway exits for 230,000 people, but no...
223,000 people.
23,000.
Very little town.
I think there's a zero too much. Actually.
My dream was to live in a town with 230,000. Yeah.
So you can see for New Yorkers, 230 sounds very small already, but I guess... I guess 23,000 is even worse. There was no cinema, and his first programming experience was actually working in the local YMCA, or the German equivalent of the YMCA, making films for people who were youthful delinquents, basically, schwer erziehbare Jugendliche. And I thought this little blurb said everything. You know, it says a lot about your interest in road movies, in travel, in transit, in highways, and in young people who are difficult characters.
Could be in this town until 1975. There are three cinemas, and all are closed. At the time of the big cinema crisis, at the end of the 70s, the last cinema crisis, and there was one shoe shop in the town. When I went with my parents to buy some shoes there, and you know the children always put their toes. Yeah, so that the parents are buying the wrong shoes and they're too small, and so I have to go with them to this shoe shop and to wear some shoes. And I remember that the shoe shop always, when I have to walk, because my father wants to see if I put in the toes. Yeah? When I have to walk in this shoe shop, it's not it's nicht eben. What's yeah, leveled. And so I walked like this, and this was a cinema before. So this was my first experience with the German cinemas. And they were totally destroyed. My mother said that she was in the cinema. She had seen on Thursday a Truffaut movie, yeah? And one day later some German movie. And so there was in the end of the 50s, at the beginning of the 60s, it was filled up with a fantastic cinema scene, and 12 years later I was walking there with new shoes. Yeah.
And what about this idea that you were located, there were two, I think you write, or at the end of those notes it says there were two highway exits for these 23,000 people.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I was thinking that idea of getting away, of being in motion.
No, there's another idea. So that this... this is in the south of the Ruhrgebiet, yeah? the town I grew up, and the whole region is filled up with highways. Yeah? And the highway 46 is the name of the highway I grew up, and it was the old trick when you are 18 and you have this driver license, you go into the highway, yeah? with a girl or without a girl, and then you leave the highway and go through the town. Eh? And then you go on the highway and through the town. Eh? And this was you were doing from Friday night to Monday morning. And then you go back to school. So this has nothing to do with road movies. It's something more to do with movies like Rumblefish or yeah? Like movies what do you call this in English? When you grew up movies. Coming of age movies, yeah. Yeah, that's right. I remember this term.
But still, somehow your characters seem really close to cars. And they're always in cars, and we're always sitting in the back seat looking over their shoulders while they're talking. And it's a very unusual way of filming people having dialogues in cars. And you stay pretty true to that, whether they're driving an East German you know, station wagons or in nice red Audis. And I was just, whether that is, you know, something that you consciously
use. Yes, something to do with the German actors after the National Socialism, where the old actors have no experience with cinema. They're always coming from the theater. And the German actors, when they are sitting behind a wheel, that's right. They don't drive really. Yeah? They drive in a studio situation with a reproduction, for example. They're always walking, working with this wheel as if this could, as if there is an expression. Yeah? And I don't like this. This expression, driving with a face and so. And when you are shooting them when they drive really on the streets, they are really, because it's like a somnambule working. Yeah? Some somnambule state of mind, you know, when you are sitting behind a wheel and you have you are 80 miles an hour, yeah? You drive through the night, you get in such a somnambule state of mind, and this I like very much. And so they don't work with a wheel. And so I'm always shooting in the car during a real driving without a trailer or something like that. And the car is very, very important for German people. Yeah? And for the German economy, and
speaking of somnambulists, because we were going to start with Barbara, we wanted to tell you a little bit about that film and show you some clips from that. When you talk about somnambulists, I have to think of the important influence on Barbara, namely Hermann Broch and his short novella Barbara, and of course he also wrote the novel The Sleepwalkers, and I thought there might be something about this idea, you know, of your whole ghost trilogy, of these zombie-like characters, these vampiristic characters, these undead figures that have other, I mean, the connection has often been made to Herc Harvey's Carnival of Souls, which was a very important predecessor text for your film Jella, where you used it. It came about actually approximately a little bit later than Jelinek, who also used it, the Nobel Prize winning author for Carnival, she also used Carnival of Souls, so it becomes this important Germanic text. But I thought also that sleepwalkers and this idea of people who walk like the undead in their own lives, somehow it fits to many of your protagonists.
I think Barbara is a part of sleepwalkers. Yeah, yeah. It's not a novel by its own. It's I think I'm really sure that it's part of the Sleepwalkers because, yeah. And yeah, the Barbara and other novels. Yeah, but the novels are out of the big novels by Hermann Broch, Schlafwandler, and in English I haven't got a memory for German titles. Yeah.
Die Schuldlosen.
Die Schuldlosen. That's right. The people without guilt.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
I think, I don't know if Barbara is from the Schuldlosen or from the Schlafwandler, but it's from one of them.
I think it's from the Schuldlosen, from the other.
Could be.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've read that in the beginning of the 80s, and I liked it very much, this novel. And I found after I have made Jella, I found in the German Democratic Republic, in the further German Democratic Republic, I found a region and a place and a historical situation to realize this novel in nowadays and not as a historical movie. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Carnival of Souls had something to do with this novel by this eine merkwürdige Begebenheit an der Old Creek Bridge von Ambrose Bierce. Yeah.
Yeah.
Und das hatte ich, I've read that when I was 15 or 16 and I like ghost stories. Okay, and Poe, and I've read everything, Mary Hottinger, and so. And so I always want to use horror and crime parts in the movies. And this is my favorite ghost story, Ambrose mm-hmm. Bierce story.
So this idea of these undead people who are walking through their lives like sleepwalkers or somnambulists, it's related to a number of factors then. So it's related to this relationship between the East, the former East and the West. It's also related to the financial crisis and what it does to people. Is this something that, you know, you thought was a good metaphor for our society today?
Yeah, when I was 30, my father was unemployed for more than 4 years. And I grew up in a little house, 85 square meters, five persons. And it was built for people where the mother and father have a sleeping room, two children rooms, one bath, one kitchen, one dining room. Yeah? And when a man is unemployed, he has to be at home for 24 hours and there's no room for him. And my father started to get a ghost. I must say, he was a ghost. He was sometimes in the garden, sometimes in the car, sometimes in my room with the headphones. Yeah? And so I thought about this unemployment as a ghost state of mind. State of mind, is it? Mm-hmm. Yeah? And so this ghost metaphor, yeah, has something to do with this death of production and industrial work.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very interesting thing to me, the way you use work in your films, because part of the problem is that work has become less tangible, right? That it's become something, you know, that's about the global capital flows that we don't see, that's, you know, takes place in these glass towers where everything pretends to be transparent but is actually completely opaque and not transparent. On the other hand, you have in your films a lot of manual labor, like people working with their hands. And that seems to, especially in a film like Barbara, and we'll show you some of that, I promise you soon. In Barbara, it seems that work, even the doctors there, you really see them engaged in working with their hands, doing things with the patients. And it seems to me that that's valorized. It's always shown in a particularly beautiful light. And there's a way in which this little hospital becomes this microcosm where a work is possible that is not possible in a film like Yellow, where it's about, you know, bankers and global capitalism and venture capital, etc.
Yeah, the German Democratic Republic, where Barbara is based, it's a republic built on work. Yeah? You have to work there. Yeah? There are no unemployed people. There are no ghosts. Yeah? There all people are working, and the love affair started during production. And in Germany and in the USA, the love stories in cinema started during the reproduction phase of the life. Yeah? When you come home out of the factory, you are in a taxi or yeah, and you met a girl or a woman, yeah? Nowadays women. Yeah? This is the reproduction. Yeah? After the workers have left the factory, love stories in Hollywood start. Yeah? And in the German Democratic Republic, the love starts before you are leaving the factory. And therefore, the manuals has something to do with erotic and seduction. Yeah? In Barbara, the Nina Hoss, or the Barbara character, she don't want to see anything, she don't want to feel anything, because she wants to leave the country. And then she see how the other doctor, his skills, yeah? And she see how he's cooking and how he's working with patients, yeah? And how he can speak with people and how sensible he is. And this is production. Yeah? And she starts to fall, not in love, but in a little bit in a seductive position, yeah? Because he can do something, because he has skills. Yeah? They have no gin tonics there and no bars and yeah, but they have other things, yeah? And these other things I'm quite curious, yeah, for, because we lost it.
So the older form of
something to do with John Ford, I must say, it was my favorite director, yeah? And when John Wayne saw someone who climb on a horse in a very good way, yeah? Then he like him. Yeah? When someone can't ride, he's gleichgültig.
Indifferent
and really deep indifferent. Yeah? And I like this, man. You can this kind of this connection between people.
We need cowboys that can ride and doctors that can operate. That's true.
Yeah, and actors who can drive. Yeah, this is also. Yeah. And open windows, entering glasses. Yeah, I like this, yeah, when they can do that.
There's something on the one hand really realistic about these scenes that you show in this hospital in 1980 in East Germany, and then on the other hand, there's something about it being almost like an experiment, right? If you put people together in one space, what can happen, right? It's almost like it, in this, I find something that carries through your films, right? This kind of, you put them together and you put them into a high pressure chamber and you see if they implode or not, right? A little bit.
It's not like this. I'm together with the actors in a pressure chamber situation. A car, for example, pressure chamber too. Especially when my family and me, when I was a child, and my two brothers and me were sitting in the back of the car. We are leaving some aunts and uncles after 8 hours of like a Thanksgiving day or so. And it was a really pressure chamber because my because sometimes my parents are near a divorce, or sometimes they're telling bad stories about my relatives. And so I know exactly what it is to live in a pressure chamber. And but I don't know, it's always so we have long rehearsals with the actors and we try to feel the space between the people and the space around the people, and like the walls are getting tighter or wider. And so this rehearsal is our basis for thinking about camera positions. Because I hate it, these camera positions from above or like these expressive camera positions. I want to that the actors create the pressure and we have to react to the pressure.
And is that part of the reason why sometimes it seems that the camera, although it's showing two people, it really only has one in focus? Everything around that person becomes somehow blurry or there's a rack focus or so. And so our attention is shifted from one to the other, but they're always kind of alone and trapped or enclosed in a space.
Yeah, so you have a space. But this modern digital television, there is no space out of focus. So we have, it's always surface. There's no room. There's no position for the camera, no position for the feeling there or the emotions there. And therefore, we are thinking also about the focus and about the cadrage and about the how is yeah focus is the right word is for focus schaffe mm-hmm. Yeah, genau.
So we'll show you the beginning of Barbara, which Christian wanted to say a few words about.
If we can look at all the movies at the first 2 minutes, I think this would be very good, because in the first 2 minutes the morality of the movie has is made. And we are thinking during the editing, we always changed the thing I have written in my script. As the beginning, I always change in the editing. The first 2 minutes I've filmed, I always cut out.
See that?
Ja. Sie wird nicht eine Sekunde zu früh kommen. Die ist eben so.
Wie ist sie?
Ja, wenn sie 6 Jahre alt wäre, würde man das Schmollen nennen.
Ist sie allein hier?
Die Inhaftierung wirkte sich zersetzend auf ihren Freundeskreis aus.
We have three positions in this first 2 minutes, which are the positions of the movie. This is the position of a portrait of a protagonist, like Barbara on the bus at the beginning. And then we have a position of surveillance. And the third thing I like very much is that the Barbara, she knows that there's someone is always
looking
at her. She starts to make posing with the legs and the cigarette. Yeah? She knows people are looking at her, and she's wearing her clothes and fantastic hairstyle and her fantastic makeup and her kind of smoking cigarettes in a very wet way. Yeah? she's using this because this is her rebellion against the surveillance, and it's very hard for her it's very hard for all people that someone who's always under surveillance and on the other side he tried to pose as a rebellion to that he can look to other people in a way that you are on the same level, without any suggestions, without any manipulation, and this you can see in the first two minutes, and this I like very much. I have seen with the actors William Friedkin's French Connection, and they don't know what this has to do with German Democratic Republic, 1980, and French Connection. There's one of my favorite sequences. My favorite actors, who's Gene Hackman, is the best actor in the world, I think. And Gene Hackman is coming home after work as a New York policeman, and there's a sniper on the roof who wants to kill him. And you see Gene Hackman through the streets, and in this moment the bullets schlugen neben ihm ein.
Miss him, barely miss him.
But some victims, a mother and a baby, died around him, and he hides himself and start to hunt the sniper. Yeah? And then this one of those most popular hunting scenes. This with a subway, and the car. Yeah? You know this scene. You have to see it again, and it starts. But what I like is that you never see from the position of the sniper. You never see Gene Hackman. You always you are on the der Augenhöhe, eye level.
On eye level.
Is das so einfach Englisch? See it from the eye level of Gene Hackman. Yeah? And I studied film, and I'm really sure that 99% of the male students, they want to prepare, stand up the camera and in the sniper position because it's very, very suspenseful. Yeah? To see Gene Hackman, who's innocent, who don't know anything, and you see him with his sniper gun, and with Fadenkreuz.
Crosshairs. Huh? Crosshairs.
Oh, nicht so schwer. But William Friedkin don't use this, and this is interesting because he said this is a New York policeman, this is a New York community, and the sniper is coming from outside, from the French killer, and he destroys with his violence this community, and I'm on the eye level of the community. But later, when Gene Hackman is hunting the sniper. The sniper is at the end of this 25-minute sequence. He's like a rat in a that's not my Sackgasse. End of
dead end.
Dead end street. Yeah, like in a dead end street, and he's and in this moment the sniper gets a position. The camera is on the eye level of the sniper because the William Friedkin has compassion with the victims, and this is fantastic. This, and I show that to the actors here from Barbara. Because I said this is also our thinking and reflection of our work, because we make a historical movie and about a communist state who's in the hand of apparatchiks, and we are inside the history, and we have to stand in the eye levels of the people, and not and I'm not cleverer, not more clever than the people from 1980. Yeah? This was. This now sounds a little bit. Sounds more intelligent 2 years ago.
I thought it was interesting in that scene that you have basically two people at that raised position looking down at Barbara, and one of them right away is coded as very sympathetic, sehr sympathisch, and the other one, Rainer Bock, who cannot be sympathetic, I fear, in film. And you have these two very different kinds of gazes there.
That's right, but both men are in a position. You've seen this Pasolini movie, 120 Days of Salo. This position of male violence is always in the first floor, in a window, and looking to the ground where people are tortured or raped, and you are in a position of power. And this, both men in this situation have the position of power. They're looking on a woman who don't know that that there are two men looking at her, and they love that, like a voyeur position. And the story is that 90 minutes, this sympathetic guy needs to go down the stairs and find a new position to this woman.
Right, yeah. To be on eye level. Maybe in that context, yeah, we could show that second clip from Barbara, because it's interesting too, because then the sympathetic character suddenly becomes a little less sympathetic. So they're doctors and they've done a night shift and he has told her to lie down.
Sie schlafen?
Ja.
Ich habe Kaffee mitgebracht.
Bettina Böhler, the editor of the movie, has been for 5 or 6 years in a psychoanalyse. I'm not, but she told me a lot about that. I'm always interested in. And she said that cutting, editing is it's like the work of the analyst. And in this scene, she changed. This scene was in the script was a little bit different, and also during the shooting, it's so that during the shooting and during the rushes and on the first rough cut, it was so that he's coming with his with a cup of coffee into the room where Barbara is half naked. Yeah? And he sees her, and for 1 or 2 seconds he stared at her, and then he's leaving the room, and she didn't recognize that he was in the room, and so this was the change of eye level and the change of camera position. This was a scene which is his scene. Yeah? We are with him, yeah? And I want to tell him that he's a guy who can see the flesh and the erotic, but also he has good Umgangsform, manners, yeah, he has good manners, yeah? And Bettina edited it like this, that both has an eye contact, yeah, in this scene, because she's looking after he had left the room. She looks in the rushes. She looks. Was there somebody or something? What was this door knock in my mind? And so how we have done this is she has done this is now it's an eye contact, and so the whole scene is more adult, between adult persons who make a little contract. Yeah, and you look at me, I look at you. I go outside, I wait, and so we can talk on the same level. And I like this, and she said this has something to do with an analyst, because the analyst changed the dreams of his client is a better word, I think. He makes an editing to the dreams and the stories and of the clients, and she has done the same thing with the material I have brought to her. Yeah? I like this scene, therefore, because it gives the whole film. It's a little scene. The whole film and also those both protagonists a new kind of adultness. Yeah?
Although it also continues. Ziemlich.
A bit like the Enterprise with this, yeah? And my body is also like immaterializing, yeah?
I promise to let you go down soon and we'll show the next clip. But there was something interesting in this scene to me too, because you know he's looking at her and she's undressed, and again he sees more. And this is one of my students actually suggested, I think very astutely. He sees more than she can see, right? Although they're exchanging eye contacts. Once again, she's undressed, right? The same way her file was always known to him, her address was always known to him. He knows more before she knows it about him. I mean, there's an acceptance of that, right, in her gaze also. That was
she's very adult because she don't say ha ha. Yeah? She's looking at him and said this I'm a doctor, I'm adult, and I know what I am. Yeah? And you can look at my flesh. Yeah? You can look at my naked shoulder, but it's no problem for me, yeah? Because I don't make these games between men and women from the 50s or the 60s. Well, I'm not feel ashamed because I'm adult. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And he liked that. He liked that very much. It's from this moment on, they have another kind. After this scene, they have a very, very big struggle in this. But it's a struggle in the discourse about living in a state of surveillance. Yeah? And this struggle, you need this kind of camera positions that both have their energy to stand this struggle, which goes on for 10 minutes. Yeah? And they're not that Barbara, she's the blonde, fantastic woman, and he's the Stalinist guy. Yeah? But after this scene, both are on the same level, and their fight is more interesting.
Yeah? I mean, I thought it was also interesting that the room that they're in is a small, brown, very familiar, intimate apartment-like space, and then he goes out into the corridor, and it's this hospital, and you can tell it's linoleum, and there's.
We have built this all studio. this is a original hospital, but they destroyed 2 years after the wall came down, Mr. President. Yeah? Two years later, they have destroyed everything which is expensive, all the wooden things, and so we have to rebuild it, yeah? The room. Yeah. But it exists, but it was a ruin. Yeah? We have to rebuild the whole hospital. All the graffitis from the neo-fascists inside are really hard. Yeah? So we have to spend a lot of money there.
So in the interest of getting Christian off the stage and out of these warm lights, we'll show you a relatively long clip from Gespenster, from Ghosts, where it's a casting scene, a young girl who lives in a home in Berlin. She is she makes a friend, Tony, on her wanderings through Berlin, and she meets her in the beginning through a chance encounter where she sees this girl being brutalized by two men in the park. And this girl, Tony, uses her and takes her along to a casting call for a TV show on girlfriends, basically. And so we'll show you that.
Girls.
Girls.
Then a Freundinnen, but it's like a little bit, in my mind, I always see this serial Girls here from, yeah. My daughter is a big fan. For me, it's very hard for males to see that, because this is the first time I saw a serial where sexuality is and power and energy is coming out of the women and not from the men. Huh? The men are so weak in this movie. I like that very much to see in a movie and or in cinema. But this casting is for a serial like Girls. Yeah?
So, hier. Bleibt einfach locker, seid einfach cool, ja? Dann macht's richtig Spaß. Geht ihr noch zur Schule?
Nein. stand an der Bordwand und dann bin ich auf sie zugesprungen. Und da hat sie mir die Hand gereicht und hochgezogen. Hm. Und
naja, und euer Boot ist gekentert, ihr seid gerettet und ihr seid jetzt auf diesem Boot von...
Jörg.
Genau. Na, wann fängt denn eure Freundschaft an?
Ja, da.
Wie denn?
Also, wir sind dann runter unter Deck. Also, wir sind dann runter unter Deck und ich war ja ganz nass, ne? Und da war ein Kleiderschrank mit irren Sachen drin. So Bodys mit Pailletten und so. Und da haben wir uns verkleidet.
Ich würde es auch ganz gerne mal von der Nina hören. Hast du dich auch verkleidet? Hm? Und als was?
Sie hat so ein Smoking angezogen und die Haare so zurückgemacht und dann haben wir getanzt, ne?
So Marlene-mäßig?
Ja, genau. Und dann sind wir ausgegangen. Und dann... Und du hast die Jean-Claude genannt, ne? Die sah toll aus. Wir haben die ganze Nacht getanzt.
Wie habt ihr euch denn jetzt wirklich kennengelernt?
Ich habe schon von Toni geträumt, bevor ich sie kannte. Das war immer derselbe Traum. Es war ganz früh am Morgen und ich ging über ein Feld. Und da war so ein Hund, hinter dem ich herlief. Und ich hätte mir immer einen Hund gewünscht, aber das ging nicht. Und jetzt war da ein Hund, ein kleiner Brauner, und der spielte mit mir. Und immer, wenn ich ihn gerade erreicht hatte, dann sprang er wieder weg. Und dann ganz plötzlich war er verschwunden. Und eine ganz merkwürdige Musik war zu hören. Und ich ging in die Richtung, aus der die Musik kam. Und da war ein kleiner Wald, ein Birkenwald. Und da stand ein Auto. Das Deck war auf und aus dem Auto kam die Musik. Dann hörte ich jemand schreien. Und ich ging in den Wald, dem Schreien nach. Und im Wald war so ein kleiner See und da sah ich ein Mädchen. Und da waren zwei Männer und die hielten das Mädchen fest. Der eine, der drehte so die Arme auf den Rücken und der andere, der wollte ihre Beine packen. Und der ihre Arme hielt, der wollte jetzt einen Kuss von dem Mädchen. Und da wehrte sich das Mädchen und der schlug der Mann sie. Und da war sie ganz überrascht und dann ganz still und das Blut lief über das Gesicht. Und der Mann war ganz nackt und stand über dem Mädchen und ich stand da, ich wollte irgendwas machen, aber ich konnte nicht. Naja, der ihre Arme hielt. Der reißt jetzt mit der anderen Hand den Slip runter und das Mädchen ist ganz nackt und sie hat furchtbare Angst und schreit wieder und da schlägt der Mann sie wieder und dann sah das Mädchen plötzlich zu mir rüber und schaute mich an und ich war dann ganz reglos und wollte einen Ast nehmen und die Männer schlagen, aber ich konnte nicht. Ich stand einfach da und sah so zu, wie die Männer diesem Mädchen wehtaten. Und die ganze Zeit über sah mich das Mädchen direkt an. Und die schrie auch nicht mehr und wehrte sich nie mehr. Die ließ alles mit sich machen. Und sie schaute mich einfach nur an. Da wachte ich immer auf. Ich kam dann wieder mal zu neuen Pflegeeltern. Wieder war da eine neue Schule und eine neue Klasse. Und in jeder Klasse gibt es eine Königin. Und in der neuen Klasse, da war die Königin, die Toni. Und sie war die schönste Königin, die ich je gesehen hatte. Und sie war das Mädchen aus meinem Traum. Und alles so richtig, was sie machte. So, wie sie lachte, wie sie auf der Heizung saß, wie sie aus dem Fenster schaute, wie sie in den Schulhof ging. Und alle wollten mit ihr befreundet sein. Und ich wollte das auch ganz toll. Ganz toll habe ich mir das gewünscht, aber das ging nicht, weil sie hat mich nie wahrgenommen. Wohl einmal da hat sie ihre Handschuhe liegen lassen. Da bin ich hinterher gelaufen und habe sie ihr gebracht. Da hat sie mich angelächelt und dann ist sie weitergegangen.
Entschuldigt. Ich wollte euch nur sagen, dass ich das ganz toll fand. Ich bin ganz beeindruckt. Wirklich. Danke, dass ihr da wart. Heute Abend gibt es eine Party. Wenn ihr Lust habt, könnt ihr da ja hinkommen. Da legt ein DJ auf und was zu essen gibt es auch. Und es wird vielleicht ganz nett. Könnt ihr ja sehen. Tschüss.
Tschüss.
I found this sequence very, very interesting, and I'm curious to hear what you have to say about it before I probe you with questions.
I want to see it again because I haven't seen it for so many years, and it was one of the most important scenes I ever made in my life because it's I learned so much from the two actors and my behavior with actors from this scene. It was so that Julia Hummer, she was also the main main actress in Die innere Sicherheit, State I'm In, and we have a very good friendship for years, and this the text was I think 5 pages in a script book, and she's not an actor. She had never been at in a school or acting school or no method acting or workshops in Los Angeles because she has to work for money, yeah, and she has don't have rich parents, and she saw these 5 pages and said, "I can't do that. It's too much. I can't learn that." Yeah? And I said, "You don't have to do it like this. You can make an improvisation. Yeah? You can. It's like you can make a song out of this thing." And the day of shooting is getting closer and closer. Then she comes to me and said, one day before the shooting, I want to do it exactly like in the script, yeah? With all commas and all signs. Yeah? And I asked her why she wants to do it like this, and she said, "Because it's not my dream." Yeah, and I like that, because I can, I have that, because it's, I don't want to take something out of my own memory. I want to have the memory or the tale of someone else, and I want to bring myself into a position to this, and I want to dream someone else's dream. And yeah, and this it was so intelligent what she said. Like an interpretation of a song by Bob Dylan, for example, you do it like in your own way. Yeah? And so we start the scene, and we have three camera positions, 335 mm, because I don't want it, I want to do it in one take, yeah? But, because you can't do it, then everything will die, yeah? when you have to, this actor has to do it 2, 3, or 4 times. Yeah? And we have these three cameras, and it was an atmosphere from the cameraman, three cameras. There's always, when the man, the cameraman has something to do, very difficult. They are like the people when die Klempner in Notfall kommen.
The emergency plumber.
Yeah, the emergency plumber, very, very. And
doesn't work, won't work, impossible.
Won't work, and please, and so we have these three camera positions, and then we start the scene. We have this position to the girls, one position which is closer to the girls, which goes from one girl to the other, and the position of this audience, with Benno Fürmann and the others, and then it was so impressive that Sabine Timoteo, the other girl, starts crying, yeah? And was really hard crying, really hard. Yeah? And I think about, I was a little bit like a what you called me in the pressure chamber, yeah? like the mad scientist. Hey, she's crying now. We have real feelings, and yeah? So, yeah? And I feel ashamed a little bit, yeah, about that. But I know that she said after I cried, because the whole thing, the whole text by the girl Julia Huber is a declaration of love, yeah? Love declaration for me. And so, such an intensity, my whole life never had, no man had given me such a declaration. Yeah? And so, we are all very impressed about the scene after. And then, 2 days later, the copy, the rushes come, and there two things happened. Yeah? The first thing is that we can't use the sound, yeah? Because they have microphones here on their naked, on their skin, between their breasts. Yeah? And the heartbeat was so hard, yeah, from both, yeah, that we can't use it. But then we have found a digitally, because the heartbeat is always on one frequency, yeah, so we can put it away. Yeah. But it was very good, boom, boom, you know, the whole, and very, it was 120, 130 beats per minute. It was a time of techno music here. And And the other thing was, something happened with the picture. The wall behind them, there's the brick wall, yeah, behind, starts pumping. Yeah. Really, yeah. And ask the cameraman, the plumper, with his three cameras, because on all three cameras you have seen that. Yeah, that is boom, boom. Yeah. And ask what happened. There was an insurance company who has sent to us a specialist, yeah, who looks at this and says, we don't know what happened there, and so we have to do the whole scene again, because you can't hear the girls, you can't concentrate yourself to the girl's story or the girl's dream or him, or love declaration. Is this the right word, love declaration? Declaration of love is better. It's like the Supremes' declaration of love. Yeah? And so we have to do the whole scene again. And this was really hard, because Julia Huber, until today, doesn't believe me. Yeah, that she thought until today that she was bad in the scene, that she can't, that she was not intensive enough. Yeah? And therefore, I make this trick with insurance company to do it again. Yeah? And so this is not the original scene. The original scene was very impressive, but we have to. Vernichten, destroy it totally, because the insurance company said we have to do that. And so we do it again, with the same positions, with the same actors. But it was also very intensive for me, but for her, it's always, when I see that scene from the back, I can see in Julia Hummer's behavior, I can see a little bit of, I hate you all. Yeah? So and this is very good for the scene. Yeah? This I want to say. This I give something. I open my heart, but I hate you all. Yeah? I think this scene is better than the destroyed insurance company scene. But it was very interesting, and I feel a little bit ashamed about that because I'm really sure that the cameraman has made a mistake, and he has failed the insurance company.
I thought it was interesting that, you know, you put in a surrogate for yourself, basically, in this scene, right? This young director who's... mise en abîme structure here, right? It's a director who's working with women, and, you know, you're, you know, like you work with women and have these great actresses who are repeats for your films. And I thought to myself, there's something about this Benno Fürmann character here. You know, on the one hand, he's able to see something and get something out of Julia Hummer, the introverted one, and he can push her to that extreme where it becomes a declaration of love, or, you know, also a declaration of traumatization, maybe also some of that terrible first scene, how they met, which is not just, you know, it's also traumatization. I mean, there's more to it, right? But then he pulls that out of her and he gets that out of her, but he's, at the same time, he's like predatory, you know, he's somewhat lecherous. And I thought it was an interesting way to stylize the director in this.
This was my really first movie with kids, I must say, there's so many directors or production companies who are telling such stories when they have found a new face for cinema over the movies. They said, we found her in a Foot Locker shop, for example, or I found her in the garbage can, or I don't know, I know, I put her out there, and this has something to do with, I think, 19th, 18th century, the ride for the first night, for innocent young flesh, and I don't like that, Benno is a very intelligent actor, the director there, we talked about that, and everybody who's working in film business knows what sexuality and Ausbeutung,
exploitation
is. I think it's working there very good, so Benno wants to have both sides. He wants to have the sensibility for that there is something. He knows there's a fresh face. We can do anything for something with. But on the other hand, all these people who are working in this economy of film, they destroy the things they love. I was with my son because we were talking about World Trade Center Manhattan. I said that King Kong has. 12 years, King Kong has also destroyed the Empire State Building, or tried to destroy it. And so we saw two King Kong movies. Yeah? The Schutzack movie from 1932, and this the last one with James Black, Joe Black, with Joe Black. Yeah? And in this Joe Black thing, he's also a director. He's filled up with energy and sensibility, and he loves to see the world, and he loves to see fresh faces, and he's opened. And on the other hand, in this moment, when he wants to make money with the things he is impressed from, he destroys the things because he made them to waren.
Goods.
Too good, yeah, too good. And this is the biography of Benno Fürmann, his character. That he's, on one hand, there is a new face. On the other hand, he wants to fuck with a new face. And in this moment, the new face is destroyed. And this was the position there.
But this fragility of the adolescence seems to be something that also interests you, right? These young people who are at the cusp of adulthood, but are still, it's so easy to destroy them. And there's this one beautiful shot of Julia Huma in The State I Am In, where she's wearing these clothes that her father has pulled out of one of these containers. Yeah. And she's standing in a parking lot, and behind her is this like garbage dump. And you see this you know, lost young thing, you know, after she thinks her relationship with this young man is completely destroyed. And and I thought there, you know, that in that one shot you really captured that, how easy it is to see these young people as garbage, or to sideline them and push them aside.
I have when I start at the film academy, yeah, I have so many seminars at by the professor Hartmut Bitomsky, who is also nowadays a friend of mine, but this time he was a professor, and I don't say ich duzte ihn nicht, was kann man in Englisch nicht machen? The first seminar was at, about Rossellini. And we saw that 10 times, I think, Germania Anno Zero. Yeah? And I was so impressed of the face of this young boy, because he's very, very young, and you can see that after in a destroyed town like Berlin after the bombs, everything is destroyed, but there's also a little bit of freedom. Because there's no police anymore, huh? And it's summer, and there are no parents, and the fathers are all dead, huh? And you can go as a child through all the ruins and play the whole day. Huh? There are no schools, huh? And on the other hand, there is no childhood anymore. You can see it in the face of the young boy. He's very old. Huh? He's 11 years old. He's very, very old, like an old adult person. And on the other hand, he's very, very young. And I'm always looking for faces like this, yeah? Bodies who are too young and they have seen too much, yeah? or they're too lonely. Yeah? And also these two girls here, I think that Julia Huma was 19 and Sabine Timoteo was 21 during the shooting. I think they're looking like 12 years old. And sometimes they're as if they're at the end of a prostitute career, yeah, in some moments. Yeah. And this I like, that people don't know how old they are, yeah, because they're lost development, yeah, continuity. Yeah. Something to do with the ghost thing too. Yeah. Ghosts also didn't know how old they are, I think.
Maybe I can open up the floor for questions. And
someone is monologizing. It's very hard to say questions. Do we have a third?
We do have a third clip where Ali dances on the beach in Jericho.
Hey! Come to us. No. Laura, guck, du tanzt wie ein Grieche.
Woher willst du wissen, wie so ein scheiß Grieche tanzt?
Ja, ein Zorbas und so.
Zeig mir doch mal, wie die Deutschen tanzen. Komm.
Komm jetzt.
Laura, komm. Zeig mal, komm. Komm, deutsche Thomas, das. Dann zeig mir mal, wie die Deutschen tanzen. Spruch.
Hasret oldu, ayrılık oldu.
Hüzünlere
die Hand hierhin.
Schön locker. Nicht so verkrampft, locker. Und zu.
Ayrılıkta
sevgiyle beraber.
Bir şarkı, bir şiir gibi. Yaşadım canım acıları. Senden
komm gleich wieder.
Hatıra. Sakladım sevgini. Taşırım sen git git acılanma. Sen ağla dayanamam. Ağlama göz bebeğim sana kıyamam.
Schöner Freund sind Sie. Wollen Sie ihm nicht helfen? Sie sehen doch, der ist dicht.
Wenn der kalırsa yaşayamam. Sen ağlama, dayanamam. Ağlama göz bebeğim, sana kıyamam.
Song is by Sezen Aksu. She's the most popular chansonniere from Turkey, and this song is a song because she is political left, really really deep left, and she's against the Turkish establishment, and she has sung this one of her most popular songs, and it's for the Greece in Turkey and the Turkey in Greece, and so when Benno Fürmann said Zorbas, and so the Turkish Ali put on a fantastic song. Yeah? And what I like in this is so I like in movies when people want to be good, yeah? Then they always are worse or more. Wie kann man das sagen, wenn Leute die das Gefühl haben, die Guten zu sein, sind oft die Bösesten. Yeah?
Those people who want to be good or believe they are good are often the worst.
Yeah, and so I have so many feelings for this character of Ali, yeah? and his being strange, to keep strange in Germany, and nobody's. He's working on a home, and he has a German car and a German house and a German blonde girl, and gives 40 Germans work and employed them. And on the other hand, nobody loves him, yeah? And he's doing everything to receive some love, and nobody's loving him. I think it's a theme I really understand, not through the education of my parents. It's more through the education of Fassbinder, yeah? In the 70s. And but I like in this scene, I like when he tries to to make them dance out of the Protestant German bodies. So that they also have a little bit, there's a sea, there's alcohol, there's music, there's the beach, and there's loneliness on the beach. What's happening to your bodies here, your German fascist bodies? And I have so many empathy and sympathy for Ali and his desire to let the German dance. And because he think when the German dance, there will be good people and I could find a part in their society. But on the other hand, he's so German. He has infected himself with this things that he put the hand of the man onto the naked back of the naked skin of Laura's back. Like, this is my car. This is my car. You can touch my car. We can make a little trip around the block. You can feel how. So like this. You can use it for 10 minutes or so. But it's my car. It's also this guy who is so good and I have so many sympathy with. So on the other hand, he's an asshole too. And I like this in the scene.
I thought it was so interesting because he's always being tested because everyone's always cheating on him and he's always testing people. So I thought also that this is his way of testing, right? And then, you know, as soon as he puts them together into this kind of pressure chamber again, then he leaves to have that raised vantage point and to look down on them and to, you know, have the surveillance status, right? And so I thought that this is, you know, although he's so drunk, in this way he's like the character that he's based on in The Postman Always Rings Twice, right? That he's testing, right?
Yeah, so that the migrants, migrants in the world, the world is filled up with 95% migrants. The other 5% earn the world, and the 95% of migrants have to find their place. So Germany is also filled up with migrants. After 1989, there were 17 million new migrants in the world in Germany. we are in move. And the people like Ali, they have to make sharp their sensibility to find where can earn money, where can find a place to sleep, where can find friends. And this intelligence, this cleverness is in Ali. I like this. And you can find it also in the James M. Cain novel, when the Greek, who was killed from the love couple, also he has the idea of neon lights for the petrol station. They have this little restaurant with gas station. And the Greek, always drinking and old songs and he don't shave himself, and but his mind is open. He's always looking where can earn money, and neon is the best thing. I like this intelligence of those migrant people because they have this intelligence because they are not part of the society. They are always strangers, and this was part of the character of Hilmi Sösser, the actor who plays Ali. On the other hand, I'm reading so many American novels, crime novels, thousands at home, but always in translated versions. I must say, I haven't got the patience to read in English because it costs me so much time, and no crime stories have to be very fast. And there's a fantastic novel by Charles Wilford, The Woman Chaser, and it's about a man who's selling cars, and he's always he's very rich because he has this migrant intelligence. He's standing on a corner and he think, could I found here in you can ich hier ein neues Geschäft aufmachen? So a new story here, and this novel 20 pages of reflecting about selling cars in America in 1963, and this is so great to have those things in a crime novel. Therefore, there are scenes in Jericho, I like Jericho, and that he and he tests the intelligence of Benno Fürmann on a corner where he said, "Well, you, when you have the possibility to build up a snack bar here, where do you think is the best place for the snack bar?" And so this intelligence is also in the movie, and I like that. Ich wollte eigentlich was anderes sagen.
Did you show any movies, maybe from the GDR or so, from DEFA? Or
no DEFA movies. Not because I have one DEFA movie is by Jürgen Böttcher, Jahrgang 45. Jahrgang? Born in 45. Yeah? But because it's, for me, it's a Nouvelle Vague movie of the German Democratic Republic. And you can see was möglich gewesen wäre. Yeah? And you can see Barbara's youth in this movie. But I never look at movies with something to do with the characters. Yeah? They'll give the characters material. Yeah? It's more for the sound. It's like a playlist. Yeah? We have, for Barbara, we have watched To Heaven Have Not by Howard Hawks, yeah? Because I think this professional doctors who are working together in a hospital, yeah? And who don't they are not sentimental. Yeah, they are workers. Yeah, and they have the skills what we talked about 1 hour ago. Yeah, when they have when there is a love affair, they have dialogues where they don't want to transport some emotions, with something to do with a very stylish fight. Yeah, for like a florette is the word in English too?
Sword
fight. Yeah? And the dialogues in Howard Hawks between Laura Bacall and Humphrey Bogart, they're throwing matches through the room and cigarettes, and they have this fantastic dialogues rhythm. Yeah? And this has showed them the both actors, and they love that scene. Yeah? So we have a scene in the hospital on the floor where they're also a little bit like Lauren Bacall and Howard and Humphrey Bogart. They are fighting with words, not the meaning of the words, with the rhythm of the words. Yeah? And this scene, this film we have seen, and we have seen. I have all these workbooks at home where there are all the playlists from all the movies. We have seen many movies. Well, we have seen Clued by Alan Pakula. Hmm? Because of this, there is a market scene here in New York. Jane Fonda and Donald Sutherland. Donald Sutherland is a private, not a private. He's a police detective, yeah? And he's Jane Fonda is a prostitute, yeah, a whore, and they both are on a night market, yeah, where you can buy vegetables and fruits, yeah? And melons. There are 20 melons on this market, and Donald Sutherland, he touched the melons and smell and taste the melons, and Jane Fonda is looking at him, and she knows in this moment a man who can touch and smell and taste melons is a man who has sensibility, and he doesn't do it for her, because he wants to have them.
Die Sinnlichkeit. Sensuality.
Sensuality. The sensuality of this man could be the basis of a love affair. Yeah? And so there is a scene in Baba where the doctor prepare a meal, yeah? And how he's going out into garden, put some things from the garden, and he's cutting a zucchini and he's cutting the onions. I think she's also looking at him like Jane Fonda have looked to Donald Sutherland. Yeah. But we have seen so many movies. But the last movie I've made now, we finished it last week. I have also a long playlist. Also, there's a fantastic New York movie where on this playlist. It was Margaret, was the name of the movie, by Lonergan, Kenny, a fantastic movie from 2 years old. Yeah? But this movie was so hard that I haven't seen a movie with the actors during the shooting. It was so hard. After 8-9 hours of shooting, everybody goes by himself into his police cell, his hotel room. But it was like a police cell, and It was like police, I must say. It was in the rehearsals before shooting. The rehearsals there, we have some movies. We have seen by Jacques Tourneur, Out of the Past, and we have seen by Robert Syed, Mac the Killers, and by Viaggio in Italia by Rossellini. But during the shooting, I must say, it was really, really hard. Yeah? The shower was cold and the room was very small.
Yeah, hello. I have a question about your interest in female agency. And I was very intrigued by the scene from Gespenster that we saw, where the two young women get to tell a story or their story. And I find that very intriguing, not just because of the scene of violence that plays a role there, but also because of the fact that you allow for them to tell their version of a story. So I was wondering, first of all, how come you're so interested in female agency as a director? And what is your relationship as the director of the film, your relationship or your relation to the director that's appearing within that scene and that's allowing them to narrate?
The first film I made, there was the main actor was a boy like I was many years ago now, but this time not so long years ago, not many years ago. And it was very hard for me to have a character in the middle of the movie, in the middle of the film, who's like me. And this autobiographical position I hate. Film has nothing to do with myself. Yeah? I have to bring myself in position, but that's not me. That's not my story. Yeah? And so I changed the character into a female character, yeah? And the whole story. I have to tell the whole story in another way. I have a distance to all the things which happened, and I like to have this distance and make a movie about distance and not about myself. Ja, richtig, richtig tolle Antwort. Also. Ja. Aber so, that's near the truth, I must say. Yeah?
In Yoko, it's obviously a remake in some ways of The Postman Always Rings Twice, but I was wondering how Ali's sickness that he has, which is later on revealed, complicates your interpretation of that film, or that book, actually.
The sickness of?
Of Ali.
Of Ali, this with the heart sickness, which is not in the crime story. I used from James M. Cain just the first 30 pages. Yeah? The other 110 pages are this fight against insurance company and this love couple is not loyal. Yeah? This is the main theme, but for me it's that it's a metaphor. This heart. Yeah? Because the when the heart is coming out of the rhythm, he has what kind of man is this? Yeah? And living in the ruins of his mother, he hasn't made anything. He has not constructed anything. And on the other hand, this blonde girl, yeah, who has sell herself to a Turkish man for some debts she has had, and those ruins. They irritated this Turkish guy, and so his heart is also irritated. Yeah? And I think this was the metaphor. But I saw that metaphor after editing. Yeah,
the choice of a dance sequence, I'm always skeptical of. Humphrey Bogart doesn't dance with Ingrid Bergman in Casablanca. Maybe she's too tall for him. But John Garfield doesn't dance with Lana Turner either. Yeah. And they have opportunities. Do you think so? When he
in the beginning?
In the very beginning? Well, I'm just mouthing Norman Mailer's idea: tough guys don't dance. And in Hollywood, basically, you had professional dancers who were tough guys, like Jimmy Cagney. We didn't know he could dance until 1945, when he did George M. Cohan. Of course, George Raft always danced because he was a real dancer who was dancing. So my feeling is it's a Bollywood influence. It disrupts a flow so much, dancing, unlike singing even.
I must say, Heaven's Gate by Cimino, you can see that all the migrants from the East, they are dancers. Yeah, and I think also the Greek in the Kane novel, also in the movie with Garfield, these are people from the east part of Europe, and they're all dancers. And I think they impressed the American music. And when I'm hearing Woody Guthrie songs, for example, I can hear the sound of gypsies from Romania. Yeah, the sound. I think the dance is coming from parts of Europe to American, not to Norman Mailer. But John Garfield, he was hunted as a communist, and therefore Norman Mailer, I think, said he's not a tough guy. There's one fantastic movie with John Garfield where he and a public swimming pool, he's meeting, he's on the run after a bank robbery or something like that, and he's going into an apartment. Tension or like this by Robert Stark. I don't know. It was a nerd 20 years ago. Shelley Winters. That's right. Yeah. He ran all the way. Yeah, that's right. This is a fantastic movie. Really fantastic.
One question I always wanted to ask you, but my memory may fail me here because I've seen your movies over the years. But one theme, because you mentioned metaphors, is that I seem to remember is wind in trees. Is that something that you put in your movies deliberately, or is that how does
this has something to do with grew up in this little town where I have this memory that there was never a wind in this 23,000 people town. Really, yeah. It's always every feeling when I go out, there was no wind, and I have to leave this town and go to the River Rhine to feel wind. Yeah? And this for me to take the bicycle to go this ride for 12 miles to the River Rhine, Düsseldorf. And there's wind. And always when I feel personal autobiographical things is when I feel wind on the surf, on the skin of my face. Yeah? I have the feeling parents are gone. I'm free. Yeah? and the other experience was the movies by Antonioni. Yeah? And I feel that when the wind is coming into his movies, something a reality is coming into this movie. Yeah? And for example, the wind in the trees and blow up, for example, in the park. Yeah? And these two experiences, the Roman, the Antonioni movies in the my first cinema experience in the film clubs of Wuppertal and Düsseldorf, and on the other hand, the stormy River Rhine. Therefore, I like wind machines in my movies. They're very loud, and I can't use the original sound in this moment, but they're very, very expensive, but I like them very much. Yeah. Sometimes I have to use the helicopters.
Well, on that note, thank you for bringing it back full circle to the 23,000 people town with which we began. Thank you, Christian Petzold, for this wonderful evening and for withstanding the heat up here.